Praise God. Amen. I can feel the presence of the Lord in here tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Gonna have to compose myself now. Hallelujah. How many are thankful for the presence of the Lord? Amen. Amen. Go ahead and grab your Bible with me, and let's look at Romans chapter 8 tonight. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. And as you are, I'd like to welcome all those online. Glad that you could join us tonight, and pray that God ministers to you tonight in Jesus' name. Romans chapter 8 and verse number 26, if you have it, say amen. Amen. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints. You got somebody praying for you. Because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Verse number 28, for we know all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to His purpose. All things. All things work together for your good. All things work together for your good. They ain't all, I know it's not good English, y'all forgive me. It ain't all gonna be good, but it works for good. I'm gonna say that again. It's not all gonna be good. I think a lot of Christians get frustrated and end up actually falling away from their faith because they come into difficulty. But He didn't promise that nothing bad wouldn't happen. But He did say it's all going to be good in the end. Amen. So my title tonight is, and I want you to tell my title to the person sitting next to you, it's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. My wife says that to Ollie all the time. You know, our dog is going on two this winter. He'll be 2 years old. And he goes from being a sweet little baby. Jerry knows, he met him. He goes from being a sweet little baby to acting like, you know, he's withdrawing off of drugs. She calls him a little lunatic. Where he would just take off from one and it's so funny. How many have been around labs before? Okay, so we have a yellow lab, and we also have hardwood flooring. So if you can imagine a dog that is, in his mind, he's going a lot faster than his paws will carry him. And it's almost like a race car spinning its wheels. And he'll just get to the point where he then talks to her. I'm not talking about barking. He runs his mouth and talks to her and basically says, go get me some more water, because he's got himself all worked up. And so then finally in the evening time after the children are in bed, that's when sweet Ollie comes back. And then she just will rub his head and say, it's going to be all right, Ollie. It's going to be all right. God never promised us life without bumps. God never promised us life without issues. And the thing that I want us to understand tonight is this statement. The presence of difficulty does not indicate the absence of God working in our lives. Okay? I want us to understand this. The presence of difficulty does not indicate the absence of God's working. It doesn't indicate that God has abandoned you. It does not indicate, I need to take this a step further. It does not indicate that you've messed up, because there's a presence of difficulty in your life, spiritually, physically, emotionally, relationally. Difficulty does not mean God left you. It's against his word to leave you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. We have a problem in America. We quote sayings like they're scriptures. And God gets the credit or the blame depending on bad teaching that we've sat under. And I'm going to give you an example. Nobody's got rotten tomatoes in here tonight, right? Don't throw nothing at me. Don't leave. Hang in with me, because I'm going to pull back the curtain on something that is quoted as if God said it, but God never said it. And that is this. I don't know why I'm going through such difficulty. God, you said you would not give me more than I can bear. Newsflash, bulletin, here we go. I've interrupted this message to bring you this announcement. God never said that. Do you really think that God will not give you something to where he's not necessary? Do you really think that God will give you the kind of life that you can live without his intervention? But God, you said, no. The Bible says he will not tempt you beyond what you are able to bear. This, I see it on Facebook all the time. I just wish God didn't trust me so much. He wouldn't give me more than I can bear. My shoulders aren't that big. I'm not that strong. First of all, log off Facebook and crack open a Bible. Because if you think Job could bear what he bore without God, you're mistaken. Right? God never said, I won't tempt you. But he never said, I wouldn't test you. Okay, it's quiet in this Catholic church. That's okay. Hear me again. He did not say that he wouldn't test us. He said he wouldn't tempt us. Because God is not the God to tempt his own creation. But he is the kind of God that will test his children the same way you test your children. Or the way you used to test your children, the way I test my children. So oftentimes I'll tell my boys to go do something, not because I want them to do it, but I want to see where their heart is. I want to see what their level of obedience is. I want to see how bad do they want the reward for doing the thing that I told them to do. God's no different. Sit, good boy. The presence of difficulty does not indicate the absence of God. What it does indicate is a growth opportunity. Amen? It's an opportunity to overcome. It's an opportunity to grow. It's an opportunity to mature. This is what we want to talk about, whether this is just tonight or this goes on for weeks. I don't know yet. But this is what God said to me today. He said, I need you to tell them to learn how to endure, because enduring makes you stronger. The Bible says, and I know we don't want to talk about these kind of scriptures, but we're going to talk about them anyway. The Bible says, endure hardship like a good soldier. Why? Because when you endure something that's not pleasant, you get stronger. What do you mean by that, Pastor? This is what I mean. You know, the old saying, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. When you endure, you come out of that saying, well, if I made it through that, there's nothing I can't face. It makes you stronger. Watch this. If you're paying attention, it makes you wiser. Not everything you end up going through is the devil's fault. Neither is it a test from God. It's the result of the fact that we're human and we make stupid choices. Huh? I laugh at type 2 diabetics who rebuke the devil for their affliction. I'm not talking about type 1s. My son's type 1. His pancreas shut down with no rhyme or reason. I'm not talking about type 1 diabetics. I giggle at type 2 diabetics. It's the devil. No, it ain't. It wasn't the devil that told you to eat a dozen donuts every Saturday morning. It was not the devil that told you to drink high sugar drinks all day long. It was not the devil that told you to eat the whole peach pie. Right? So we live that life for years, and all of a sudden our pancreas is not working the way it's supposed to be working, and then we say, it's just the devil. He afflicted me with type 2 diabetes. No, he didn't. You afflicted you with type 2 diabetes. You understand what I'm trying to say? Not everything's the devil's fault. And oh, God gave me type 2 diabetes. There's not one scripture in the Word that ever says that God gives anybody a sickness or a disease. And this is, we're going to be talking about this in the future, but I'm just going to say it because it's been on my heart this week. Sickness and disease is not something that you are given. It is a revelation that something's been taken away. Because God created humanity to walk in perfect health, divine health. Sickness and disease is the revelation that something is missing, not that something's been given. Are you here? That is what the word disease means. It is dis-ease. All right? Not that that has anything to do with tonight, but I just thought I would give you a little free appetizer there. All right? Enduring makes me stronger. Going through stuff makes me stronger. When I get the revelation that if that didn't kill me, there's nothing I can face that's going to be able to take me out. I get stronger when I endure. Watch this. The only way an athlete gets stronger is when he works out with resistance. Resistance strengthens your walk. So there's a few things we want to talk about. I don't know if we'll get to all of them, but we'll just see how the day goes. The first thing I need you to understand about, well, if it's going to be all right, if you're going to understand that everything's going to work together for good, you got to understand this one crucial point, and that is this. God is still God in the midst of tragedy. God is still God in the midst of tragedy. In the midst of tragedy, He's merciful. But here's a revelation. Y'all ready? Somebody has it worse than you. Somebody, somewhere, is going through something that is worse than what you're going through. God is a merciful God, isn't He? God is a merciful God even in the midst of tragedy. God gets a lot of blame for something He has nothing to do with. Yeah, because of how He created us, He does allow tragedy, but He never causes it. Number two, if God is still God in the midst of tragedy, not only is He merciful in tragedy, He's loving. Now, I need you to understand something. Love does not always prevent pain. Just because you're going through something doesn't mean that God is not the God of love in your life. Sometimes love is at work in our life in the midst of that pain and in the midst of the suffering. The second thing about love is that love stands strong in the midst of the pain, in the midst of the suffering, in the midst of the tragedy. The Bible says that love never fails, right? The third thing about love is it sees you through. It sees you through. People need to pay attention to what they say. Oh, Pastor, pray for me. I'm going through a hard time. You just prophesied to your own life and you didn't hear yourself. What are you talking about? I just said I was going through a hard time. Right. You just admitted you weren't going to stay there. I'm going through this hard time. I'm going to get on the other side of this hard time. I'm not staying here. There's an old song that says, when you're going through hell, don't stop. If you catch hell, don't hold it. Keep going. Right? Love sees us through. Now watch this. You need to understand that because He's the God of love, He will not allow you to stay in that place. He will take us by the hand and He'll march us on out to the other side of that thing. Amen? So He's a God of mercy. He's a God of love. And number three, His grace is sufficient. Now, there's a false doctrine out there that says all you got to do is ask God to remove something and He'll remove it just because you ask. The Apostle Paul thought the same thing. And then he said, three times I prayed. Three times I prayed. God, remove this thorn from my flesh. Nobody knows what the thorn was. Nobody knows what it was. It could have been church leadership that wasn't paying attention to him. It could have been family. It could have been their form of media back then. We don't know what it was. It could have been something afflicted in his body, or it could have been something plaguing his mind. But the Bible says that a messenger from Satan, a messenger from Satan had come to him with a thorn in his flesh, and he said, three times I asked God, take this from me. Take it out. Remove it from my life. And three times God said no. Stop thinking that when you hear God answers prayer, that the answer to that prayer is always yes. Three times he prayed, three times God answered. Remove it. No. Take this from me. No. God, you're the God of deliverance. Deliver me. No. Why not? My grace is sufficient. Ain't that good news? So he's merciful, he's loving, and he's sufficient with his grace. He has more than enough grace. Now, I do believe that when we pray that God answers, and I do believe that when we go through difficult times, God sees us through. But I'm here to tell you, if you're going through something that doesn't seem to be getting any better, it's not because God isn't involved. Number four, he doesn't cause tragedy, but he uses it for a purpose. Do you remember 9/11? Huh? Do you remember that? Nearly 20 years ago, when those planes crashed into the Twin Towers and the Pentagon, and everybody, you know, half the folks were blaming God, the other half, you know, were blaming, you know, the forces of terrorism or whatever it is, however they handled that. You remember those days? And nobody thought there could be a worse tragedy. Now the only time we talk about it is September, when we reflect and honor those that lost their lives. And the point I want to make to you about that is that God did not cause 9/11 to happen. But do you also remember in 2001 how America went back to church? Do you remember how America started to pray again? Do you remember how America started to worship again? Do you remember when God became number one again? That was God using a tragedy for a greater purpose. And quite frankly, we didn't learn our lesson. I'm not going to chase them bunny trails. I see like 40 bunnies running. I'm not chasing none of them. But you understand my point? You know, and I'm not saying that we're going to have another 9/11, but what I am saying is God will allow tragedy in our lives to turn us to Him because there's a greater purpose. There's a greater victory coming. He uses tragedy to get us to where He wants us to be. Number five. He loves us enough to allow us to go through it. What do I mean by that? Two points I want to make. Number one, you'll never know how much faith you have until it's been tested. I'm a man of faith. How do you know? Because God said I had faith. Has your faith been tested? Have you had an impossibility? Have you had something spoken over your life that your faith had to rise to the surface? Because that is when you know that you have faith. You do not know you have faith because you went to a revival meeting. You know you've got faith when you're getting unfriended and posted about and tweeted about and getting nasty phone calls and nasty letters and all that kind of stuff. That's when you know you've got faith, is when you rise to the top when everything else is trying to pull you down. You know you've got faith when the doctor looks at you and says you will die and cannot live. You know you got faith when the lawyer gives you a bad report about your marriage. You know you've got faith when all hell breaks loose and nothing you do works. I pray and pray and pray and nothing changes. I worship and nothing changes. I testify and nothing changes. I shout and I dance and I spin and I cry and nothing changes, because God wouldn't be a good God if everything was easy. I would be a poor father when my child was a baby and they got to be a toddler and learning how to walk, going from crawling to walking. I would have been a bad father to always hold his hand and say, this is the way you walk. That's it. I would be a bad father if my wife had grabbed his hands and I put my hands on his feet and showed him how to walk. That is not what a good father does. A good father is close by when they don't know what they're doing. But when they get the hang of it, a good father steps back, because if you don't ever get an opportunity to walk, you'll never know what you can and cannot do. When I was learning how to swim, my dad would be real close and he would say, come swim to me. And I hated to swim over the water. I hated it. The water splashing in my eyes and it just felt weird. And so I forced my way there. And then I was only about 4 years old. And we were in a swimming pool. He backed up a little bit further. He was about 5 feet away. And I, without even thinking, I knew I hated the splashing of the water. So I dunked under the water and swam 5 feet underwater and touched his stomach. And he pulled me to the top. And he's like, great job. Let's do it again. And he backed up double the distance to 10 feet. And I remember being a little kid and I was so scared. But I kept thinking to myself, and I remember this at that age, I kept thinking to myself, if I open my eyes and see my father, I know I can do this. So then I went under the water and in one breath, just a little fishtailed him all the way underneath the water and grabbed his stomach and he pulled me up and began to praise me and tell me how good I was. Next thing you know, I remember being 5, 6 years old, jumping off a diving board in 10 feet of water and in one breath swimming from the deep end to the shallow end in our pool. And it didn't happen because my daddy showed me how to swim. It happened when my father removed himself enough where I could prove to myself I could swim. That is the way God does with us. At first, he holds our hand and helps our feet. But then he says, but now I need you to learn how to walk in the thing you've received. So he withdraws himself a little bit. And then we endure and we walk and we get a victory. And just when we think life's going to be easy again, he withdraws himself a little bit more. And it forces us to walk in the faith we say that we have. It is not because God is always near that our faith gets built. It is when God removes himself that our faith gets strong, because he will never put us in a position where he has not already equipped us to overcome. You don't know how much faith you have until you're forced to use it. Ain't that right? I can teach my boys all day my patented turnaround jump shot. Y'all laugh. I'm serious. I can teach him how to do that all day. But if I don't walk off the court and give him the ball, he'll never know what he is or is not able to do. See, some of us in our spiritual lives always want Jesus on the court. But Jesus ain't always going to be on the court. He's got to go upstairs and fire up the smoker. Ha ha! Hallelujah. All right. You understand my point? Oh, God, I just want you to hold my hand through this. You know what he says to that? No. Walk. Do the things I've equipped you to do. The second thing I want you to see about that his love, that he loves us enough to allow us to go through something, is that the true measure of a man is revealed in difficult times. You don't know who you are because life's easy. You really don't know what you're made of until you've been through hell. You don't really know what you're made of until you've been through something so hard and so difficult and so stressful, and it forced you to tap into the things that God put on the inside of you. When you go through something so emotionally wrenching that it reveals to you what manner of person you really are, and the reality is the first time this happens in our lives, we don't like what we find. We don't, oh, listen. Man, listen. I needed, my grace is sufficient the other day. I said something to my wife and she died laughing. She's still laughing about it. Why? Because anytime you go through something that's stressful, can I take it a step further? Anytime you go through something that's annoying, I'm the only one in here that gets annoyed, apparently.
No, I get really.
But anytime you go through something like that, it is not, hear me, it's not about the situation. It's about revealing to yourself what manner of person are you. And I found out the other day, I got some stuff in me that's got to get cut out. Huh? Don't look at me all pious and, you know, like, oh, I thought you was the pastor. No, listen to me. Every one of us has got stuff that God needs to take the scalpel of his word and cut it out of our lives. I said to my wife, I won't quote what I said, but I said to my wife the other day, I'm like, they're working my nerves. Before you try and figure out who it wasn't a church person, okay? And it wasn't a family member even. Can't family members annoy the mess out of you sometimes? It's like the people closest to you are the ones that get on your nerves the most. But it wasn't a family member. It was a company. And this company, I've always been a big fan of. They started to test. And I wasn't dealing with them as Pastor Tim. I was just dealing with them as Tim Marr. And I was having some hard times. And my wife, and I know I'm teetering. I know I'm teetering when I get this. I love you. Like I know you love me. I ain't helping. Can anybody relate to what I'm talking about? It's like she's trying to calm me, trying to soothe me. I love you. I know, but your love doesn't help them. Can anybody relate to what I'm talking about? I feel like I'm on an island here. Okay, some of y'all know what I'm talking about. And so I realized the other day, there's some fragments of old Tim Marr that's got to get worked out, right? There's some fragments in us, and you don't realize the work God needs to do until you go through something. Until somebody says something to you that quite honestly lights your fire. And I'm not talking about the Holy Ghost. Can anybody know? And I'm not an angry person. I'm not. You know, some of y'all have been around me. You know, I'm laid back. I'm relaxed. I'm cool. I go with the flow. But there's a couple things that you light my fire. You're going to get the flesh end of Tim Marr real quick. And so, but praise God, it all worked out after all. But you know, it wasn't the day I was on fire about it. That was the day it got worse, Mark. It was the next morning after I had a chance to pray. Everything worked out, right? To the praise and glory of Jesus Christ. Had nothing to do with me. This life is not void of trouble, is it? But we can rest assured in something tonight. We can rest assured in the eternal fact that God is on our side. You know, he's still, I want to say that this is going to free somebody in here tonight. Y'all ready? He is for you, even when you don't resemble who he wants to make you. I'm going to say that again. Some of us need to hear this tonight, whether you're in this building with me or you're watching online. God is still for you, even when you look nothing like what he wants you to be. Well, I don't know that that's scriptural. Look at the Apostle Paul. God did not count against him the persecution and the murder of the church. He called him in the midst of it. Look at Peter. Jesus walks up to Peter, says, "Hey, before the rooster can run his mouth three times." I learned to say that because we did a revival next to a farm one time. And that stupid rooster was up at 4 a.m. every single morning, running his mouth. We weren't even getting in the bed till 1:30 in the morning because church was going so late. Stupid rooster. I told the pastor, I said, "I'm about to have chicken for dinner if that thing don't shut up." He said to Peter, "Before that rooster runs its mouth three times, you're going to deny me. Three times you'll deny me. But I have prayed for you that when you are converted, your faith would not fail and you would strengthen your brothers." Why? Because Jesus was for Peter when Peter looked nothing like what he was called to be. Whew. Isn't that good? God is for us. This life is not void of trouble. Oh, to God that it was. Do you know what you call life with the absence of trouble? Being raptured. Going to heaven. Receiving a robe of righteousness and a crown of life and walking on streets that are made of pure gold. That's a life void of trouble. But the last time I checked, we on asphalt. And our bodies are not glorified. Trust me on that one. My body has not been glorified. My wife and I had a discussion not that long ago. Something weird happens after you turn 40. Let the church say, amen. I promise you this is the gospel truth. The morning of my 40th birthday, both my knees and my ankles popped, and they had never made a sound before in my life. Yeah. They were greeting me on my birthday, and they ain't stopped popping since. All right. This life is not void of trouble, but we can rest assured that God is on my side. God's for you. You know what? When God looks at you, believe it or not, he does not inquire as to what your political associations are. He doesn't ask you if you're Republican. He doesn't ask you if you're Democrat. Because he doesn't care about the elephant or the donkey. He cares about the lamb. You understand what I'm trying to say? And yes, politics are important, but they're not more important than the kingdom. Now, hear what I'm about to say. When he says, "I'm for you," he's not for which person you vote for. He's for you. He's for you. He's on your side. If you are in a situation in your home where it doesn't, there's no encouragement there and there's nobody walking this life of faith with you, I need you to understand that God is for you. God is madly in love with you. He's head over heels about you. And he's for you. And because he's for you, this is what I want us, I'll close with this tonight. This is what I want us to take away. I want us to take away from this message this one eternal truth. Because he's for you, he will allow you to go through something. Why? Because of what he put on the inside of you. Well, it just seems like if God was the God of love, like you said, he would prohibit these things. That's not Bible. Let me give you one last example before we pray tonight. Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. The Bible says that with tears and great drops of blood, prayed in the garden. He toiled. He fought. He wept. He cried. There was sweat dropping. There was he prayed to the point that he was bleeding. And he said this one prayer, Father, if it's possible. He already knew it wasn't. He knew it wasn't possible before he agreed to become an infant inside of someone he created. He already knew it wasn't possible, but yet his humanity said, hey, about this agreement, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And his father looked to him and said, no. You were born to die, and the cross is your purpose. And if he did not spare his own son, the Bible says, how shall he not also with him also freely give us all things? That's the God that we serve. That he did not spare his son because he wanted you to have a relationship with him. Amen. Listen, next Wednesday, we're going to take it a step further. And when I say it's going to be all right, this is the reason why. Because the Holy Spirit is in you, and he's working through you. And you don't want to miss that in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand to your feet all over the room? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this word. We thank you for your promise. And I pray, God, that our faith was stirred tonight. Our faith was built up to know that going through something does not mean we've missed it. Doesn't mean we've made mistakes. It doesn't mean that there's sin in our life. Going through difficulty simply means you are growing us. You're maturing us. You're strengthening us. It's an opportunity for you to show your glory on our behalf. And we pray, God, that each and every person would be strengthened, would be equipped, and that they would receive an impartation of faith that causes them to walk in a deeper place of faith. Before we are quick to say, God, deliver us, let us look for what you are putting on the inside of us. And thank you, Lord, that you will not leave us in difficulty. You will not leave us in times of hardship, but you are ever present, walking with us. And we just pray, God, that your name would be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Before you are dismissed tonight, if I could get a couple of ushers to grab the baskets, they're going to come forward. And our dismissal tonight will be you giving an offering into the house. Amen. No, this, well, if you want to cut a check for $7,000, we'll receive it. This is tithes, offerings, whatever you want to sow towards. Amen. And so, and if you could just put on some music, we're going to have you come forward and give your offering, and you can consider that to be dismissed. God bless you. Yeah. Okay.